Welcome to part 5. The DM's guide opens with a crawl about what's in the book and what being a GM entails. Similar to the player's handbook, the book is split into three parts: worldbuilding, adventures, and running the game. That said, the only real stand-up from the typical advice in the opening part is the section on knowing your players, which shows certain playstyles and how to engage them. A nice touch, to be sure. Before we continue, I should note that there's going to be a lot more summarizing in this book, since much of a DM's guide is general advice with little in the way of hard mechanics. Chapter 1 starts with advice on building your world, using established campaign settings as some examples. The world's core assumptions, its pantheon, religious systems, then going on to mapping the world itself, giving numerous examples of possible settlements and government. In the section on factions, the optional mechanics of renown is introduced, which is a score of 1 to 50 that demonstrates your rank in that organization, though a character may have renown in multiple organizations. Unfortunately, most of the benefits this section goes into are more fluff than mechanical crunch. The creating a campaign section gives advice on how to progress a campaign scale, and introduces the idea of world-shaking campaign events. It comes off as being almost like the nation system in Exalted and Weapons of the Gods, but lacks the crunch of those systems. Further into the chapter, it talks about various flavors of fantasy, from swords and sorcery to mystery to wuxia. In several instances, wuxia especially, it implies that a simple name change would be all that's needed to accommodate certain settings. I don't entirely agree. As I've stated before, I'm a follower of system matters. And as such, I think that just reskinning the name but having the same mechanics is shortchanging the genre, in my opinion. The mechanics must fit the setting organically. Chapter 2 talks about creating a multiverse, using the multiverse in the D&D cosmology as their example. A lot of the stuff brought up here when it comes to planar travel is very reminiscent of Planescape, with mechanics of gateways, supernatural weather like psychic winds and ether cyclones, and the time displacement of the Feywild. After that, the book details the Outer Planes, a reincarnation of the Great Wheel cosmology from previous editions, each one having an optional mechanic associated with it. While each place is given a fair amount of detail, I feel that too much time in this chapter is spent dedicated to the setting of the planes, or how to make interplanar games engaging. The first chapter in Part 2, Chapter 3, talks about creating adventures. Creating adventures' three acts and different styles of it are detailed here, with a bunch of charts to determine random starts. While many of these are welcome, I think they could have added a random adventure flowchart in summary somewhere in the chapter, so a DM could see how it all comes together. After that, the chapter talks about creating encounters. Some advice is given concerning the XP threshold for a character's level, but this dives into the same problem that challenge rating has, as I discussed in the last part. Especially difficult is the fact that the monsters in the monster manual don't have an index by level, just alphabetics. Random encounters are also discussed, and while the bulk of my attitude towards them was hinted at in the starter set, here I'll add that random encounters run the risk of cheapening the monsters, especially since there's no minion HP like in 4E that there was to smooth things out. I'm not saying they're bad, but they have the potential to be used badly unless taken with the right approach. A hex crawl would be a strong example of this. Chapter 4 is focused on creating and playing NPCs. The chapter opens with a few random charts for an NPC's appearance, mannerisms, etc., and then going into the raw stats of it. This is done in one of two ways. A, adopting a monster stat block like the one in Appendix B or the Monster Manual, or statting them out like a player character, using challenge rating instead of level. Further discussion on NPC types is had, ranging from hirelings to outright villains, as well as an optional mechanic for an NPC's loyalty. In addition, the chapter discusses two new subclasses for potential NPCs, the Death Domain for clerics and the Oathbreaker for paladins. Putting aside the issues with the nine alignments for now, since both of these require evil characters, I am not fond of these options being in the DM guide and not in the player's handbook, since I think there's equal potential for a Death Priest as a morbid hero, or a gray heroic Oathbreaker as any other class choice. It's something that could add potential tension and drama to a character and how they interact with the party, or with the NPCs in an adventure. Chapter 5 talks about adventure environments, specifically the dungeon and what forms it can take. This includes details and charts on its location, inhabitants, history, hazards, and how to map the completed dungeon. In addition, the wilderness is discussed as an in-between and how it can potentially fill that time between towns and dungeons. Details are given for how to use survival skills a character may have in detail for the wilderness. This is expanded upon with alternate environments like undersea and skies as well. Finally, the chapter delves into traps. Well, it talks a lot about the kinds of traps a party might encounter and the way to balance save difficulty and damage. Very little in terms of an effect guideline is given. There's a few examples, but nothing in the way of a real creation system. Chapter 6 is about using the downtime between adventures. Much of it pertains to what characters might do outside of the main adventure. This can include making magic items, planting adventure seeds, running local places, and so on. Despite all the charts presented, however, there's very little in the way of a real set of mechanics to make this downtime more than a DM abstraction. Chapter 7 deals with treasure. Much of the treasure detailed here is rolled on random tables, dictated by the challenge rating of an encounter, with a separate set for treasure hoards, presumably at the end of a dungeon. Magic items are also introduced in this chapter, with their own as treasure tables in the same group. Like I said in the starter set segment, I'm not fond of the rule about attuning, since it seems arbitrary to have all characters only able to attune 3 magic items, especially since it's not clear for what the threshold for magic items power that would warrant attunement. There's only a vague guideline later on in the book. Magic item creation itself, compared to previous editions, is a bit lacking since it's a series of random charts for properties and quirks. Instead of being based on levels, we have this ad hoc approach to what a new magic item can do, and in the process remove the idea of magic items growing with the players. Further, more effort seems to be placed in the magic items already created than in creating your own. Though on a positive note, the artwork used for the various items is pretty damn great, even if the organization for it was all over the place as they only organized the items A to Z. Following that is a segment on sentient magic items, which had a small amount of mechanics to reflect this, but it's mostly just fluff charts. In addition, artifacts are discussed, and add a set of property charts unique to them as well. Near the end of the chapter, alternative rewards are given, which seems reminiscent of the reward alternatives in later 4th edition material, but the only ones that had mechanics here were epic boons, which seemed to be a way to grant levels to 20th level characters or culminating a reward after a major quest. Chapter 8, the first chapter in Part 3, talks about actually running a game. Most of the early part of this chapter is standard fare concerning how to use mechanics and role-playing effectively. Midway through the chapter, combat using miniatures is discussed, and a lot more in-depth aspects are treated as optional rules in the text, such as flanking and marking. On an interesting note, however, the book's inclusion of hexes instead of squares as the DM wishes, which is an interesting take. Chases are discussed in the same section, but since it's going for that ad hoc narrative play, it doesn't do much to differentiate itself from normal combat, save for a few charts to complicate things. After that, the section delves into some minor mechanics on siege equipment, poisons, and madness, each of work with a light amount of crunch. Chapter 9 is called the Dungeon Master's Workshop, and is composed of a series of alternate mechanics or uses thereof. There's a lot of that here, ranging from alternative uses to proficiency and skills, to the introduction of hero points which allow you to add a d6 to your d20 roll. 2 new potential ability scores are introduced here, Honor and Sanity. While it does go into detail on the settings they'd be appropriate for, it doesn't do much to take advantage of them beyond skills and saving throws. And not even much at that. Later on, the book delves into creating a monster. While the process shown appears to be very in-depth, there's very little advice for balancing the new monster beyond balancing the creature's hard stats and adding a set of traits from a chart. In addition, crossing PC classes over with a monster's stats only seems to overcomplicate things for a game that's trying to build itself on simplicity. The remainder of this chapter delves into crafting new character abilities and options, including spells, magic items, races, and backgrounds. With a couple exceptions, much of the material given here is more advice on making an effective fluff, and little in the way of crunch to balance it. The primary exception here is spell points, which can't be skimmed in that manner, due to the nature of a spell point mechanic and its relation to the spellcasting classes. The book ends with a set of appendices, the first acting as a random dungeon generation chart. After that comes an organization of the monster manual entries by environment and challenge rating, something that should have been in the monster manual in my opinion, and finally a set of maps, DM inspiration books, and an index wraps up this book. So, after a starter box set, and 3 books worth of material of the alleged world's greatest role-playing game, as it claims on the cover, where do I stand on it? As I stated at the beginning of this review, I followed the playtest of the game extensively, and had some things I liked and some things I did not like. For me, it felt like they were running away from every good idea they had in general, and any idea that came close to resembling 4th edition specifically. The game was billed from the start to me as a uniting of the editions, which in retrospect feels like a PR move giving out how hostile the edition wars were with 4th and 3rd edition. Adding to the idea is they tried this whole uniting the editions thing with essentials for 4th edition, but that ultimately was a flop. However, trying to combine the previous editions was a doomed plan, because the design motifs in some early ones have not aged very well, whereas others create irreconcilable conflicts where you have to choose one side. Additionally, I can't say I'm fond of how Crunch was written in the book, since it opted to blend it with a fluff in a way that bordered on purple prose. While this may make it smoother to just read on your couch or something, when looking up a specific rule, this is an annoyance when you just want to look up one effect. This is the reason why I keep hammering home the addition of summarization pages in my other reviews, and, spoilers, that will continue to happen in the future. D&D's idea of a default campaign setting has always been bizarre, where they have things that would point to such a thing, but don't have a real default world. In 5th edition, it seemed like they intended for Forgotten Realms to be its default setting, given its popularity due to other mediums, like in video games. However, I find it to be an unwise move, especially if they're going to demonstrate how the game can accompany other genres of fantasy when it clearly can't escape the Tolkien melting pot they've built up for the last 40 years. A point of praise I often hear about the game is its simplicity. And to that I say that's true, but it's at the cost of having a character have a real build. The concept of an optimized build based on abilities, feats, class, and race is something that the game has an adversarial attitude towards, despite that being an integral aspect of what makes the game mechanics fun. Ultimately, when I look at a lot of the things that were introduced or changed, I have to repeatedly ask myself what direction they were going in, what their real game plan is. And every time I do, the conclusion comes down to one word: backwards. The material in these books was like reading the thoughts of a man who has been flagellating himself for the sin of anything that isn't old-school play, but not willing to go full OSR, which is indicative of the approach that this game takes as a whole. The big tagline in this game's praise is that it is a greatest hits of the editions. In a way, that's true. But it's not true in the way that's intended, because this is the gaming equivalent of a greatest hits album. By that I mean you've got a bunch of disparate ideas designed around a low common denominator, thrown together without a real unified voice on their direction. I had considered waiting longer for this review to see if a later supplement would fix this issue. However, since its next few releases are mostly going to be adventures, and they intend to focus on that, I think it's safe to say that this is what I'm stuck with, an appeal to nostalgia's common denominators instead of an examination of the additions compared to what they wanted to do. It's a shame, since there are a few good ideas here and there, but they're mired in a foundation that has no real direction and wants to go back to a safe zone for safety's sake. So, in the end, I must give Dungeons & Dragons 5th Edition a 4 out of 10. Thank you for watching my longest review yet, and my first review of 2015. With any luck, this year will hopefully be better than the last. That said, my next review is going to be delving into science fantasy. Take care, everybody.